We have a source file and we want to, now we have a requirement to get a count of all the records in this source file. So it's all the records, there's no key as such, we are not grouping by any column. We have to get what is the total count of records in this source file. And then we have to create header and trailer records and write it into a single sequential file with a header, with the data records and the trailer records. So we can just see how we can implement that using all the stages that we have seen so far. So the first stage itself, let's use a transformer. Now here we have no other option, but we'll need to use a transformer. And now since we need to create the header record, the trailer record and the data records, that means we need three output links out of the transformer. So we will take three output links out of the transformer. So we'll name them properly so that we can identify them later. This will be our header. These are our data records. This is our trailer. Now, what I want in my header record is the file name, the source file name. Data records will be whatever are the records and coming from the input link, all those will be passed as the data records. And in the trailer, I want the count of records that are coming from my sequential file. So again, there are many ways to do this, but we look at this one way. So we have the header record where we want the file name. So we'll create a column there and we'll call it just rec, and we'll define the SQL type as var, length as 20, nullability as yes. Now I want the file name, so how can I get the file name of the source file? I've already need to define it as a parameter. So if I have defined it as a job parameter, I can just go to the job parameter and select the file name. So that is for my header. I just need the file name as the header. So I have all the information for the header. For the output, for the data records, I just need all the columns going to the, all the data records which are coming in, which are all the input records and all the column values. And for the trailer, I want to get a count of all the records coming from the source file. So I'll just take one column here. But I cannot group by the department ID. I do not need a count based on the department ID. So we'll see how we can use the aggregator. So this is okay. Now I have the record in the header. I have the data record and I have the trailer record. So I have taken one column in the trailer record, but I still need to find the count of the rows. So for that, I need the aggregator. But before that, because I want to find a count of all the records and I cannot do a group by on the department ID, I need a dummy column on which I can do a group by. So I need to create one more column, a dummy column. So I can do it in the transformer straight away. I can just go and create a dummy column. But we'll see another stage which can help us to create a dummy column. So again, that is the debug stage. Like the row generator stage we had, there's also a stage called the column generator. And these are debug stages because they help us to generate dummy data for the columns or for the rows for testing purposes. So if we do not have that column, we can just use a column generator. It works the same way like a row generator. and I'll take an output link out of this. And as we click on the column generator, it will ask us that how do we want to generate the column. Explicitly means I will write the name of the columns I want to generate, or the other way can be a schema file. I can use a schema file that has a metadata defined, so accordingly it will generate the column. Now, if I want to type in the column name, I'll choose a method as explicit, the column to generate. So it's some dummy column, so I'll just say dummy. Now I go to the output. I need to map. I just want the dummy column. Dummy column is the column I'll be performing my group by on. So if I want to count the record for all the records that are coming in from the input, this dummy column needs to have some constant value for all the records. So to do that, I'll again go to the columns. I'll double click here. And the same way as we did for the row generator sage, we can define an algorithm or rule based on which we want to generate the value. Now I want all the records to have the same value for this column. So I'll just select one value and I'll just give one value. So I can give any value. I can give dummy itself as well. But whatever is the value, that will be a constant value for all the records. I can say okay. So it will add this dummy column that we have generated, but the number of records would remain the same. Whatever is the number of records coming in as the input for this stage will remain the same. For all those records, it will create one more column and add the value of 1 to that column. Now I can go to the person category, pull out my aggregator stage. Take an output link out of the aggregator stage. And here I need to define a group by column. So my group by would be on the dummy column, which has a constant value for all the input records. So it will be able to count the number, total number of records. My aggregation type is going to be count source. So it will have this one dependent property, which is the count output column. So again, I'll give the same name, rec, to this. In the output, I don't need the dummy column anymore. I just need the count. And I can just drag and drop it. Now, if I go to the columns in the output tab, I'll see that the data type is double. I need to change this to varchar. And I'll define the nullability as yes. So these kind of implicit conversions can be done in these stages. There would be a warning in the job log, but since a double column value or an integer column value can always be passed to a varchar or a string column, this implicit conversion would be allowed. But we cannot do the other way around. We cannot pass a varchar value to an integer column because that will not be allowed and the job will fail. This is again, we'll rename it. So now this is my trailer. I have the count, I have my header, and I have the data records. So I need to combine all the data coming from these three input links. So the sage that I need to use now is a sage that can combine all that data into a single output link. So again, we have a stage, we have a processing stage, which is the funnel stage. So now I need to use my funnel stage. I'll take my funnel stage out. And I'll connect all these input links to the funnel stage. And take an output link out of the funnel stage. Now, funnel stage has a requirement that all the data that is coming to it from all the different input links should have the same metadata. So same metadata means same number of columns, same data type of columns. It should be same. Only then it will be able to combine that data coming from the different links and write it into a single output link. So for now, if we just click on the funnel stage and go to the output tab, there are no input columns which are available for taking out to the output link. And that is because we don't have common columns across all the input links. So the first thing that we need to consider here is that we need to define common metadata for all these output links coming from the transformer and going as input to the funnel stage. So that is the reason we need to keep a common column name, define this common data type. So now if I go back to the transformer, I'll keep the column name as rec for record. I'll keep the column name as rec. I'll keep the SQL type as varchar and I'll keep the length as 20. Or I'll rather increase the length to 100 because we are going to concatenate the values in the column. So I'll keep it as 100. So now this should be a data type coming out from all the output links of the transformer. So for the first link, which is the header, it is okay because it's only a file name that we need to pass and we can define any kind of output data type for it. So we have defined it as varchar 100. Now for the second link as well, which is my data record, I need to have just one column and that one column should have the data type of varchar, the name rec, and the length should be 100, nullability yes. But I have two columns coming in from my input. So now what I need to do is, I don't need these two columns. I need to define just a single column by the same name. So that would be rec again. Data type should be varchar. The length should be 100. And I cannot have any other column, so I'll just delete this column. And now in this output column, I need to combine the values of all the columns for the same record that is coming from my input link into this one single output column. So basically what I need to do is concatenate the column values into this single column. So here, I'll just select my input columns. So my first input column is the department ID. I'll use a concatenation operator, which is a colon. Then I'll define some delimiter. So I'll define a pipe so that I can recognize that these are two different column values. So I'll define a delimiter and concatenate again with the second value, second column. And that is the reason we need to define a larger length for the varchar data type so that it will allow us to concatenate all the columns which are available in the input data. So for us, for now, it is only two columns. In other cases, there might be more than two columns, so we need to define a larger length. Now my trailer record is basically, it is not coming out from the transformer directly. It's going through the column generator and the aggregator. So whatever is the output column coming out of the aggregator should be having the same data type because that is the one that is input to the funnel stage. So we'll go to the output, we'll go to the columns, and we need to change this length to 100. So now we have data coming out from all the output links of the transformer and the same metadata for all the input links of the funnel. So now if we click on the funnel, we should be able to see the input columns. So there's one input column available now for mapping to the output. So we'll first define an output and we'll define a sequential file. and the sequential file. Let's see if we have any variables. We have the file path. And this is the output file name. Okay, we can leave the mode as override because we don't care about the mode. We'll go to the formatting. We do not want any of this formatting. We have just one single column that we're going to map. There won't be any delimiter specified for writing to the sequential file because I've already specified in that one single column that I've created in the transformer. So I'll just go, I'll say remove all. So it will remove all these properties. So I do not need to define any default values. I can just remove all those properties. And I'll say okay. Now if I run this job, so we haven't mapped it. Okay, so go back to the funnel. Go to the output tab and map the column to the output. Okay, so now we can run this job. Okay, so now we had 8 records in the input. What we have got are 17 records in the output. So that is obviously wrong because we should have got only 10 records. 8 data records, 1 trailer record and 1 header record. So we see what has gone wrong. So this is my trailer record that is coming out from the aggregator. And that is just 1 record. So that is fine. I have my data records, which would be 8 records. So that is also fine. So the problem is with the header record. Because we have just specified the file path and it has considered all the input records and specified a file name for all the input records. So now we need to restrict it to just 1 record. So again, we need to go back to the transformer. And again, there are various ways to do that. We can, if we want, we can use a remove duplicates after that. But what we'll do is in the transformer, we'll define a constraint so that only 1 record will be output from the header link. So if I go to the header constraint, I have some system variables available. So if I right click on it, go to the system variable, I have something called the enrow num. That is the row number for the input records. And they can be only 1 input link, so that's okay for us. So in row num, we want just 1 record. So we want to specify in row num equal to 1. But this row number is based on the partition as well. So this is actually the input record number for each partition. So for every record, if you have 4 partitions, for every record, you will have 1 record which will have the enrow number as 1. So that will not restrict the record to just 1. So we need to define another condition. So we will define it again by another system variable. So if we right click again, go to the system variable, we have something called the partition num. So we'll use that as well. and equal to. So even if I don't know how many partitions I have in my configuration, I'll have at least one partition, and the partition numbering always starts with 0. So if we put as 0, we'll make sure that it is picking up from the first partition, and one partition will always be there. So we can safely say 0. So if it is for the first partition, it picks up just the first input record and generates an output record for that. This will restrict my header to just a single record, and now I should get only 10 records in the output. So now one record should come out of the header link, one is already coming out of the trailer, and 8 will be the data record. So now I have 10 records. But if I look at the data, so basically what we're expecting is that the header record should come on top, then the data records will come, and then the trailer record should come. But if we look at the data that we're actually getting in the output, we have some random data records, then we have the trailer record that has the count of the records, then we have the file name which should have been the header, and then again we have some records. Data records. So this has happened because this is a parallel job. So it runs on multiple partitions. And also because while defining the funneling, we did not define explicitly that the data should be combined in a particular order. So for that, we need to be careful. One thing we should always remember when we are trying to generate anything in a sequential order, that it is a parallel job. And even if we say sequence, so if I say sequence here, sequence basically means that it will read the records from the first link, then the second link, and the third link. So if I say sequence here, I need to then be careful about defining my link ordering. So I have to go to the link ordering tab, define which is my first link. Now, in this case, by default, the header link has become the last link. I do not want that. I want it to be the first link. So I have to take it to the top. And then I have the data link, and then I have the trailer link. So that is okay. That is the order I want it in. And I have defined the property. In the property, I have defined the funnel mode as sequence. Whereas by default, it is continuous. So continuous is random. That's why we got random results. That is okay. We want it in the order of the links, and we have defined the link ordering. So that in that case, we need to define the funnel type as sequence. So even if in this case we run the job, we'll again get the data in some random order. And that is because this sequence would be followed within a partition. So for a partition, it will read the records from the first link. For one partition, then another link, and randomly it will read records for the second partition. But we want the whole data to be sequential, irrespective of the partition. So in that case, we need to go to the Stage Advanced tab. and define or change the execution mode from parallel to sequential. So sequential would mean that all the data when it is getting collected will be processed to a single node. So sequential always means that the data, the processing will happen on a single node. Whereas if you define parallel, and most of the stages by default will be parallel, that means that processing will happen across multiple nodes. You can just say okay, and you can run the job. This is again just one way of doing it. There are many other ways in which we can do the same thing. Let's look at the results first. So anytime you design a data science job, there are various ways to do the same thing. So in this job itself, we did not need the column generator stage at all because we could have generated a dummy column within the transformer itself. Now again, I have time records, and if I view it, and looking at these icons also, we can see that the data has been collected. So it's flowing sequentially through the funnel. It's coming from multiple links, multiple partitions, and getting collected when it's flowing through the funnel. So now if we look at the data, it is in the proper format. The first record is the header record and it has the file name as we want it. The other records are the data records and they are concatenated, the department ID and the department name concatenated with a pipe as we defined in the derivation in the transformer. And the last record is the record count. Yes, it will come up again. Okay. And the last record is the record count. So that is the way we wanted, and we had defined it to run in the sequential mode to achieve this result. We wanted it in a particular order and we had to run the funnel stage in a sequential manner to achieve this. Now there are other options as well. This is okay in case when we have we had just a few records. We had just 10 records in the output. So that is okay even if we run it in a sequential mode. That would not matter too much. But if there are, let's say, a lot of records, there are a lot of data records, millions of data records, then if I run it sequentially, then the whole job would be too slow because all the processing will be done on a single node, which is not what we want. We want to use the parallelism of data stage to make the job run faster. We do not want to run it sequentially and slow down the job. So there are other methods to do it in the funnel stage itself. There's another mode. So we have three modes in the funnel stage. There's a continuous mode that will randomly pick up the data. There was a sequence mode. So we defined the sequence in which it would pick the data in order from the first link, the second link, and the third link based on the link ordering that we defined for these links. And there's another mode called the sorted mode. So in sorted mode, it will pick, it's like the partitioning, key-based partitioning. So it will sort data based on the key column values, and then it will produce the output in that sorted order. So to achieve that, what we would have basically needed to do is we would have created some dummy columns in the transformer for the header call, for the header record. Let's say we would have created one column called the key column. For the header record that is coming out, we would have put the value as 1 for that key column. For all the data records that would have come out, we would have put the value of the key column as 2. And then for the trailer record that is going here, we could have put the value as 3. And then in the funnel, we could have defined the sorted mode in the funnel and defined the partitioning in the funnel based on that key column. So it would have sorted based on that key column. So the first record would come at the first point. The second record would come. Second record would be all the data records. So the first record would be the header record that would have come at the top. Then all the data records would have followed that header record. And then the trailer record would have done. So that would have been another way to achieve this. And what would have been the advantage of doing it that way? We would have been able to retain the parallelism in the job. So if there are millions of records, if there's a large volume of data being dealt with, then we do not want to run it sequentially. We want to retain the parallelism. And in that case, it would have given a better performance. The whole data stage job in itself would have given a better performance. So that is another way of doing this. So for everything we implement in data stage, there would be so many other ways to do the same thing. So it's only depending on how many stages we are using and how many operations we can compare. We can combine in a single stage that we need to decide which way we should go. So if we are already using a transformer, probably it's better to do the calculations, the counts and all within the transformer itself, the sorting, the partitioning within the transformer. If we are not using transformer, then it is always better to go for all these independent stages, because these are always faster because they are in the data stage native format and they do not need to be compiled to any other external source. Whereas transformer will always be a heavy resource, heavy stage, because it will need compilation through an external C++ compiler. So this is basically an example of how we can create header and trailer and combine it into a sequential file. Now this is one way of, this is one of the ways in data stage to do it. The other ways and simpler ways to do it, if you have a Unix-based server, then you can just create your one header record into one sequential file. You can write the trailer record into another sequential file. You can write all the data records to another sequential file and use in Unix when you are running the job through Unix as an after step. You can concatenate those files together in that order. That would also result in the same thing. That would also result in the header data and trailer records. So that also can be done. Then again, for calculating the input record count, instead of going all this way, if we have the file on the Unix server, we could have run in the script that calls the data stage job, we could have done a wc-l and created and counted the number of records, obtained the count of the records through the Unix script. Because in the backend, whenever in our production environment, we're never going to run a data stage through a data stage designer or a data stage director client. It has to be automated. So these data stage jobs, so we'll see in later sessions, these need to be called through the Unix script. And then in turn, those Unix scripts are scheduled through some schedulers like AutoSys or SONTAB or any kind of scheduler, whichever is available for the system. So those Unix scripts are then scheduled. So a data stage job is called through a Unix script. So in any case, we are using a Unix script. So all these kind of operations can be done as in before and after Unix script statement as well, instead of doing these through the data stage. So that is also one option. In most practical scenarios, that would be an option. So any questions on this?
No, I think we're good, thank you.
Okay. So we have completed most of the stages now. I just need to show you the surrogate key generator stage and the slowly changing dimension. So in our next session, before that, we'll understand a little about DataStage configuration file in our next session and some of the admin properties, some of the other files, admin files, which are available. And then we'll try to do a job that can implement the SCD. So again, with SCDs, it's the same thing. It can be done in multiple ways using different kind of combination of stages. So we'll see one or two ways of doing that as well. And then we'll move on to the job sequencer and the other DataStage features as such.
Okay, cool. Great. So we'll speak on Monday then.
All right. Okay. Yeah, sure.
Thank you.
Thank you. Have a good weekend. Bye.
You too. Bye-bye.